right. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
So my name is Michelle Dubois. I know most of you in the room, and I really wasn't expecting all the television cameras, but that's the way it is. I am going to start out by... Some of you have been to other discussions on difference that I've hosted. So I'm myself, Representative Shayna Barnes, Representative Moses Rodriguez, Bob Sullivan, and who was the other person? You, Bob, Moses, and myself are co-hosting these discussions on difference. It's a discussion series. So you'll remember that last month we read the first three pages of John Lewis's foreword, Walking with the Wind. It's one of my favorite little sections of his story where he talks about how him and his friends, when they were children, were able to hold down their aunt's shack in Alabama from the windstorm. And we discussed what the parable is in our lives and how the windstorm may be different things to different people. So, just as luck would have it, this month we're discussing diversity and immigration issues and how what it's like to be an immigrant in Brockton. And the last one is going to be around religious differences. So just so everybody gets an idea that we're really trying to touch on all the differences. So panel discussions will focus on how race, gender, disability, and economic class affect how we see each other. We will develop a plan to lift up our area's diversity as the positive it is, reminding our neighbors that we are all in this together. So that's the mission and the purpose of these discussions. I want to thank everybody for being here. Typically, we do not televise these discussions, and just as luck would have it, we decided that we were going to televise this discussion so those at home in the immigrant community who may be afraid to come out into the public library still have an avenue to learn about their rights and their families and their loved ones' rights. So I'm going to introduce the legal aid attorneys that are here, Sarah to my left and Brian to my far left, and I'm going to hand the mic over to Councillor Barnes.
I echo my colleagues' sentiments in welcoming everybody here. Thank you for coming. This series definitely touches on a bunch of different topics. It's not just one kind of laser focus. It just seems today it happened to be a laser focus issue, but it's important. The information that these attorneys and that Juliana and Bishop Texera are going to share, it's information that goes to everybody, no matter what, when it happens or what time it happens. So I actually reached out, Representative Dubois asked me to reach out to someone that I knew, and I knew someone who works with the ACLU, and he's a friend of mine actually for more than 10 years, and he's a brilliant, brilliant attorney, and he is the director of the Racial Justice Program, Rahsaan Hall Esquire, and again, like I said, he works for the ACLU, and they've been very busy as of late, as we all know what's going on. So I do appreciate him being here, and I'm sure we'll all learn so much from what he has to say going forward.
Thank you, Councillor Barnes. So to start things off, what we're going to do is we're going to ask the legal aid attorneys to do a little talk about that they've done many times in our community about knowing your rights, and then our friend from the ACLU is going to talk about some of the more broader issues that are going on in our state. And then we're going to talk to the folks from Brockton and also our members of the MIRA Coalition to kind of sketch out some of the fear that's in our community that's real, and hopefully make a connection with our neighbors in a way to help people get documented, to know their rights, and to understand the system better so they can take care of themselves and their children. So I'm going to pass down the mic to Sarah.
Thank you. Thank you, Michelle. So we just wanted to come today and share a bit of information that, as Michelle said, we've been sharing in the community for some time, particularly since the election. The immigrant community understandably has a lot of fear at this time, sparked by some of the comments that then candidate Trump said on the campaign trail. And since he's been in office with his executive orders that he's put out so far, there is definitely a lot of fear, and we're hearing it from all of our clients and all of our community partners. So we've been doing Know Your Rights presentations in many different locations, in churches and schools and health centers, to let the immigrant population, but everybody know, because these are important rights that everybody should keep in mind for themselves and for their friends and family. Every single person who is in the United States, whether they have immigration status or not, has certain basic rights that are below the United States Constitution. So President Trump cannot change any of those rights with any sort of executive order, or they can't be changed by the Congress either. So those are the kinds of rights that we're trying to educate the community on right now. So these rights, very basically, are that every person has the right to remain silent when confronted with law enforcement, whether it's police or an immigration official. Everybody has the right to ask to talk to a lawyer. And in the context of immigration, what we try to let everybody know is that, you know, they should never feel forced to sign something that they can't understand, or even that they can't read if it's in a language that they don't speak. So these are some of the really important rights that we talk about.
So you have the right to remain silent, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have the right to ask for an attorney.
Mm-hmm.
And what was the final one?
It's not a right, but it's the fact that you never want to sign anything without being able to understand what it says, and you want to make sure you talk to somebody who understands the language and who can read it to you. But you really should be talking to an attorney, because immigration is very complicated, so you always want to make sure you know exactly what it is that you're signing.
And here in Brockton, we have kind of pro bono legal services. Immigration attorneys.
Yep, we have at the Justice Center, where Brian and I work, we do have immigration attorneys, so we're able to assist low-income clients who have immigration questions. There are also a number of community organizations that folks can always go to for advice or for referrals. We have Community Connections of Brockton. We have BIC, Brockton Interfaith Community. We have the Latina Women's Association. And then we also have social workers in the hospital who are very good contacts for folks who have questions.
You know, today, just to pop in, today I got some phone calls from people in the hospitals that work for the hospitals that said a lot of their patients have been very scared lately about immigration status for themselves and their parents. And so I'm really happy that you're here. And I think that you were even giving a session there today as well. So thank you so much. Sorry to be so rude.
No problem. Do you want anything?
What number should they call? And I'll get it popped up for the television on cable access. The 508 number? I can get up the legal services number while you talk. I'll get that number.
We'll take a look for it.
I can find it. Oh,
yeah. Which is the intake line? Yours?
Yes. 800 number.
800? Okay. 800-244-8393.
Thank you.
I should know that quicker off the top of my head.
Thank you.
On the telephone number, we have offices in Fall River, Brockton, and Hyannis. And if you call any of the local offices, you'll get through to our intake system, and your inquiries will then be forwarded to the appropriate office and attorney. So there's multiple phone numbers. I would say use the 800 number, because that's the easiest.
And so just, I guess, the other main message that we like to talk with immigrants about, and with the immigrant community, is to understand that oftentimes when immigration comes into a community, it's more so they're sort of doing an investigation to try to find folks who don't have status, or, you know, don't have a process ongoing at the time. And so what we always remind immigrants is that, you know, don't tell immigration where you're from. You know, you can We have red cards, which we can certainly get some to Michelle Dubois. These red cards are cards that are available to citizens and non-citizens alike. And they basically have written in English a message to whatever law enforcement officer you're encountering that invokes those very important constitutional rights that I just talked about without you having to say it. So it has a message in a language you can understand on one side. We have some in Spanish and Portuguese and Haitian Creole. And on the other side, it's a message to law enforcement or to immigration that says, I don't wish to speak to you. I don't give you permission to come into my house. And I'd like to talk to an attorney first. And so that in terms of letting anyone into the house, that's another thing we talk a lot about with our communities.
Great, I'd like to touch on that. Can you hear, do you think you can hear me over there on cable access?
Oh, okay.
So I often get phone calls from people that worry just about this issue, about what they're supposed to do if someone knocks on their door. So it's interesting that you also get calls about this. And I know what I've been told to tell my constituents, but it's nice to hear an attorney now explain it to the audience. So thank you for explaining what people should do if ICE knocks on their door. Thank you.
Definitely. So if one of the very important rights that the Constitution grants us is that you don't have to let anybody into your house, whether it's a stranger or it's immigration or it's a police officer. You have that right to your privacy in your home. So what that means is that if anybody comes to your house and knocks on your door, you should always ask, who is it? Who's out there? If it turns out to be somebody from immigration, you should ask for their name and for what agency they're from. But just understand that the biggest piece of advice that we can impart is not to open the door, because opening the door can be taken as an invitation for whoever it is to enter your home. So we say don't open the door, and ask the officer or whoever it is to show you a warrant. Because if immigration doesn't have an arrest warrant to arrest you or a search warrant to search your home, you do not have to go out to talk to them, and you do not have to let them into your house. So we ask folks to either have the warrant slipped beneath the door to them so they can look at it, or held up through the window so they can look at it. And we let them know it to be valid. It has to have their full name, their correct address, and it has to be signed by a judge. And if any of those things aren't there, then it's not a valid warrant. So immigration does not have the right to be entering their house or to arrest them. If all of those three things are there, we advise that folks go outside the house and close the door behind them rather than invite the officer into the house, because that again lets them, you know, that gives away your right to privacy in your home. So those are some of the really important things we talk about. And even if the valid is warrant, and if you go outside to, you know, speak with the or to even just say to the officer, yes, that's me, you can always still just hand the red card and say, you know, you want to talk to a lawyer, and you're not going to answer any other questions.
So do you think that when you give your Know Your Rights sessions that you give, are those the topics you touch on? What other types of topics do you touch on? That's it? That's about it?
We are really focusing on knowing your rights, because right now we don't know. There's a lot of unknown factors. You know, there are executive orders that are out that have changed some priorities, but we don't even know exactly how those are going to play out, because it's all so recent and so new. So the thing that we want to get across is that, you know, it's just really important that you know how to respond in a way that is not going to put yourself in danger, or, you know, give some information to immigration that they perhaps didn't even have about you to begin with.
Have you been talking to people from the community? Have a
a lot of people been calling legal services?
Yeah. I mean, there's definitely a lot of fear in the community right now. So we're just trying to get these kinds of messages out. We're trying to let everybody know that we're a resource and that all of those community organizations that I talked about, they're also resources.
So BIC.
Community
resources.
Mm-hmm. Latino Women's Association. Cape Verdean Association.
Cape Verdean Association. They do a great job in the city.
Anybody else here? Coalition for Social Justice.
Yep.
Haitian United. Is that the whole organization? Yeah. Would any Haitians United for Progress, South Shore, SHOOP. Sorry. Hello. So we have cable access here as well as some news channels, just so everyone knows. Would either Bishop Texera or Juliana like to speak a little bit about the, or anybody else, speak a little bit about the fear in the community?
I will say sometimes the lack of information can be a really a big issue in the community, not only for immigrants, but in general. Right now, because there's so much misinformation and in some cases real information regarding some things that are happening in the community, the fear has been rising and rising. For the longest time, the immigrant community have lived in fear, but right now it's becoming to the point where it's affecting their children, is affecting our school system, is affecting everyone in the community. So even for the people that are not immigrants, if you're sending your kids to school and their peers are living in fear, it's traumatic. So I mean, right now we're living in a time in our country where personally, I'm an immigrant myself. I never imagined this country would actually allow itself to become what it's becoming. I can probably think of times where in European countries like Germany and other countries where such things has this kind of fear has happened, and I can't even begin to imagine how much trauma the people that lived in those places have have endured. And I will say more and more families are coming to us, whether they are documented or not, with very real feelings and fears. And I do work with a lot of social workers and therapists, and the level of anxiety among young people, it's increasing to the point of developing even more mental health issues. So I think this is not only an immigration issue, it's not only for the immigrant community, but I think Brockton area as a whole should really analyze what is happening and find ways that we can all work together to decrease the anxiety, decrease the fear that our families, our neighbors, the kids that are going to school with our kids are facing. So the Family Center is here to support anyone that come through our doors, anyone that have fear. So we are located at 1367 Main Street. Actually, I'm terrible with phone numbers, but I will look it up in a little bit. We are open. We are open from 9 to usually 8 o'clock at night most days. Saturday, sometimes Sundays, even if we need to serve families. We are funded by the Department of Children and Families and under the United Way of Greater Plymouth County. And I'll definitely give the phone number to the TV so they can put it under, because I'm terrible with remembering.
Thank you very much.
Yes, myself and Juliana, actually we served, or we are serving the Board of Mira for over 15 years. And just for the record, I came to this country to work with refugees and immigrants. That's my vocation. Second, me as a young man, and what's that I do? I had a lot of experience working in immigration over 20 years. And as a director of Immigration Pastoral Center, lately the amount of people are coming to our doors for application to become U.S. citizens has increased. High numbers of people are doing that right now. So people are taking very serious what's happening right now, this new administration. Nonetheless, as a community, what we're trying to do is educate people, no matter who you are. We know people of color, minorities, who are targeted no matter what. It doesn't have to be immigrant. I mean, just by the color of our skins that people are targeted. We call that racial profiling, even with immigration issue. That's the problem. As a young man, when I was studying racial profile here in Massachusetts and going around, you know, I can tell it exists. It's still existing even today. This morning, myself and Tracy Gutierrez, I had the privilege to drive around Brockton and knock the doors, go to the house, and see the fear in the people's face. And I can raise my hand and tell you that's true. We did knock a door on Plymouth Street, and it was confirmed that ICE and the sheriff department was there, and so forth. So this is not a lie. I mean, this happened. It's been happening before Trump with Obama and everybody. Right. It's happened. But right now, it's more because right now what you see, there's a lot of hate from individual white men who, for some reason, don't understand that we are human beings, that we all need to come together and build this nation how it was built the beginning, since its beginning. So the fear that's hurting us is only divide us, make us losing what democracy is in America. So we are here as a community, as a clergy, as a faith community organization, just to make Brockton a better city. If we're going to call ourselves champions, this is the time that we need to show love and care. You know, and for the Catholics, men and women out there, who actually, so many of them, you know, are causing a lot of pain and suffering in this community, I'd ask you to listen to the teachings of Pope Francis. Compassion, love. And to you, brother Catholic, sister Catholic, you know, this is a time of Lent, it's a time of repent. Start a new life, start to love your neighbors. Brockton is a small city that we all can love each other. We can build, like the Irish, like the Germans and so forth, the Polish build this city. We Canadians, we Haitians, we Latinos, we can do that too. So let us come together and let us support one another. That's what we're doing. We're trying to educate and organize people to understand we can make Brockton a better city. Thank you.
Thank you. So I just thank you very much, Bishop Texier and Juliana. I just wanted to say that you brought up the Pope, and so I grew up Catholic. I'm still Catholic, though I you know, the whole church scandal with the sex abuse kind of put a little worry in my relationship with the church, and really Pope Francis is bringing me right back. And I'm his Facebook friend. So everybody knows there's a lot of controversy on Facebook. I'm Facebook friends with the Pope. And every once in a while, we get these wonderful Facebook messages from the Pope because he uses technology. And he says, in God's heart, there are no enemies, he said on Saturday. God only has sons and daughters. We are the ones who raise the walls, build the barriers, and label people. We live in a time in which polarization and inclusion are burgeoning and considered the only way to resolve conflict. We see, for example, how quickly those among us with the status of stranger or immigrant or refugee become a threat, take on the status of the enemy. And really what we're doing here and with all these dialogues on difference is to kind of break down that anger and hate that it's so easy for any of us to feed into. I mean, I would just last month when we were talking about some of the racial divides and the prison, the school to prison pipeline, and how our judicial system sometimes and oftentimes goes against low-income people of color, and there's been laws made specifically to kind of incarcerate people, not taking ownership over those things, but looking at them from an independent lens and trying to make the world a better place. So I always love it when Pope John Paul has Pope Francis had, because I like Pope John Paul too. So Pope Francis comes out with these wonderful statements because it really reaffirms for me and the Catholics in my community that sometimes fall into this fear-mongering against immigrants that, you know, Jesus, you know, he lived a pretty tough life himself. And maybe if he was here, some people might not be very, might not love the real Jesus, that walked on the land, that was a refugee. So I'm just trying to help with that and help people to get over their fear. So I just want to tell this little story. So I have a friend who's from Vietnam. She's wonderful. She's a United States citizen. She has a 9-year-old son who came home from school one day crying. And she said, oh, honey, and she has the best accent. And I can't do a Vietnamese accent because she's a beautiful person. And she sounded so wonderful when she said this. And she says that her son comes home and he's crying. And he says, you know, mommy, a couple of my best friends at school tell me I have to find a new mommy and daddy because you guys are going to be deported and I'm going to have nowhere to live. But one of my best friends said that his parents will be my new mommy and daddy. But he's crying because he loves his best friend, but he doesn't want to go have some stranger be his mommy and daddy, even though he likes his best friend's mom and dad. So this little boy that said this to my friend's son, he said it because he loved his friend. And he was like, don't, you know, when you're, he doesn't know, he's 9 years old. He says, you know, when your mom and dad get deported, you can come live with me, he says, right? So he said it from a place of love. But what did it do to that 9-year-old? That 9-year-old went home, told his mother, I have to find a new mommy and daddy, crying. She said it took her 3 hours to calm him down. She said, don't you worry, you tell your friends at school that your mother is a citizen and you're going nowhere. And if I was ever kicked out of anywhere, that you would come with me. I would not leave you behind. But this is what people and children that have parents that just have accents are going through. So little kids are just assuming that they're all undocumented and that they're all what people call illegal. And in fact, they're just immigrants that have an accent. So there is some, this is like, I think this cuts through, this story should cut through to anyone in Brockton, in my district at home watching this, that these are just little children. And this mom is documented. This mom's a United States citizen. And her little son, you know, had a lot of terror. And just because she calmed him down, I'm sure he still worries about that. And that's the beginning of some PTSD. So we want to remember that there are children around us when we make some of these comments. And we want them to be strong adults. And not for nothing, these children are the children that live among us in Brockton. They're not, I mean, they may move with their parents, but they're not going anywhere. So when we degrade someone's parents and we degrade that child's inner self-fortitude and his pride in himself and his family, we're really degrading our whole community. And so it's something we all need to work on. And I'm sorry to preach, but we got this camera and usually it's a discussion, but hold on. I'm going to pass it on to the ACLU attorney. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Representative Dubois. Again, my name is Rasan Hall. I'm the Racial Justice Director at the ACLU of Massachusetts, and I appreciate this opportunity to have this conversation that's also informative. It's important that people are knowing and learning what their rights are because there's a lot of misinformation out there, and there are a lot of rumors that are floating around out there, and the better informed people are, the more stable and secure our communities can be. I think what has been lifted up and what I've been hearing really raises some significant concerns about what this whole conversation is about and who we are talking about. Because this conversation around immigration, we're not talking about the thousands of undocumented Irish folks who are in the United States or the undocumented Canadian people. We're talking about black and brown folks who have come here seeking a better life, people who have come here seeking refuge, people who have come here fleeing oppression and violence. And never once do we engage in this conversation with the consideration of the very reasons why people are coming here. A lot of times there are those who would just focus on the fact that there are people here who came here illegally or came here and overstayed their legal documents and are now somehow taking resources from other people, from those who legally belong here. And I think that's a very divisive conversation, and it's very problematic, and it sets us back as a nation. Now, a lot of people will say that we are a nation of immigrants to underscore the spirit behind this sense of unity that we should have. I usually take umbrage with that comment because there were some folks that were here before immigration started, and there were some folks that were forced to immigrate here. And it's on those people's land and on those people's back that we exist as a nation. That said, there have been millions of people who have come afterwards of their own volition, but also fleeing persecution and fleeing oppression and also seeking a better life, that have contributed to the beauty and the artistry and the tapestry that make this beautiful fabric of America that we have. With all of its warts and failures and shortcomings, there are a lot of things to value. And so we can't lose sight of that. And we also can't lose sight of the role that our country has played in other nations destabilizing their economies and perpetuating violence and funding coups. And so when we turn our nose at people who are coming here seeking refuge and sanctuary, we really need to be turning our noses at ourselves. The role that the American Civil Liberties Union plays now and has played for almost the last 100 years has been to be a defender of civil rights and civil liberties. The motto is that freedom cannot protect itself, or freedom can't defend itself. And so we are committed to defending constitutional principles of liberty and democracy and freedom. And so in doing that, we saw what was coming down the pike in this last presidential election. And, you know, for some of us, we are experiencing this new presidential administration, and there are a lot of people that are gobsmacked. They're saying, what in the world is this? I cannot believe what has happened. This is not the America that I know. But then there are a lot of people who say, yeah, this ain't nothing different. This is what we have been seeing and have been experiencing for generations. It's just amplified a bit more, and it's reaching a broader group of people. And so now other folks are getting engaged in the conversation and paying more attention. But when the ACLU at our national level, as well as here in Massachusetts, began to see the trends and see what the potential threat was to our liberty and to our system of democracy, we began to prepare. Candidate Trump laid out what his plan was for the first 100 days. And based on those things that he said he was going to do, we identified all of the things that we found unconstitutional. And we prepared strategies to address those things. And no sooner than he was sworn into office, we see a Muslim ban. And, you know, people say, well, it's actually a travel ban. Look, if it looks like a Muslim ban, it acts like a Muslim ban, and is talked about as a Muslim ban, it's a Muslim ban. And so the minute that that ban came down, there were immigration attorneys that were at Logan Airport because they heard that people were being detained and not being allowed in the country. And ACLU attorneys and attorneys from the American Immigration Attorneys Association, or I always, Lawyers Associate, AILA, yes, were both there getting as much information. And we were able to file a brief on a Saturday night to get the court open up on a Saturday night to file this brief to request a temporary restraining order to block the execution of this ban. And we won, which was a tremendous victory. And then there was a case that was filed in Washington challenging that same ban. And what was underlying the victory was how this ban was talked about before it was executed, right? Because on the campaign trail, he talked about creating a Muslim ban. He talked about keeping Muslims out of the country. He had this anti-Muslim rhetoric all through. And then he had his surrogates, Rudy Giuliani, out saying, yeah, he asked me, how do we create a Muslim ban that will withstand constitutional scrutiny? And so this is what we came up with. So, like, you can't change it. And so after the Ninth Circuit, a court of appeals ruled that that ban was unconstitutional, they said, well, let's give us a mulligan. Let us do it over again and withdraw it, and we'll introduce a new one. And so that's what they tried to do. But you can't erase the rhetoric that existed before that. And if to say, well, we'll take one country out and we'll make some tweaks here and there, the spirit behind what that was intended to do has not changed. And so that is another point at which he has failed at this. There's also an issue that the ACLU has been involved in on the issue of ICE detainers. Essentially, when an individual is held by a law enforcement agency, the Department of Homeland Security or ICE will send a detainer, which asks these local law enforcement agencies to hold an individual for them for 24 to 48 hours until they can get there to take that person into custody. The problem is that they are not based on probable cause. And in order to detain someone, the Article 14 of the Massachusetts Declaration of Rights and the Fourth Amendment to the United States Constitution require that there be probable cause to detain an individual. And these ICE probable cause is that it is more likely that there is articulable facts to demonstrate that an individual has committed a crime or is in the process of committing a crime. And so without providing any probable cause or having any judicial determination that this individual has committed a crime, it's simply a piece of paper that is asking the law enforcement to do a favor by holding someone against their rights. And so, but there are sheriff's departments and courts and local law enforcement that have agreed to do this. And so there's a case pending in court now. We filed an amicus brief or a friend of the court brief and are asking to be heard on that as well. So those are some of the lawsuits that we've been involved in to challenge some of the things that have been coming out of Washington, and in particular because ICE detainers are nothing new, but what makes this time or this moment in time different is that before, ICE detainers were prioritized, right? They were looking to have people detained who had orders of deportation, people who had serious violent criminal backgrounds. Now that those prioritizations have been removed, it's subject to the whim of whoever the ICE agent is. And given the discriminatory, xenophobic rhetoric that has been behind some of these executive orders, there's another constitutional issue as to whether or not these detainers will be executed discriminatorily or not. So those are some of the legal challenges that we've been involved in, some of the other work that we've been in. And I got to give a shout out to my colleague, Laura Rodolo, who's been very active and involved in Brockton, is trust acts or trust ordinance, where is essentially getting local law enforcement to agree that those local resources are not going to be used to execute federal immigration laws, right? Because there's value in community feeling like they can trust law enforcement. There's value in knowing that you can go to the police to report an incident of domestic violence, that you can go to the police and report an instance of somebody who has committed a crime. But if there is this fear that law enforcement is going to come and check even not your own immigration status, but the immigration status of a family member who may be home while they're investigating, people are less likely to report those crimes. And as a result, communities become less safe. Right. And so, so the Trust Act work has been happening in a lot of cities and towns throughout the Commonwealth. And then finally, there's some legislation that has been introduced at the state level that we've been advocating and pushing for. The one bill is the Safe Communities Act, which is essentially
close to a statewide TREST Act that would, you know, preclude local law enforcement from investing its resources into executing federal immigration laws. If the feds want to come in and detain people, if the feds want to come in and do raids, let them do that on their own dime. Let our local law enforcement use their resources to investigate and do law enforcement that our communities need, as opposed to chasing people based on their immigration status. And so that's what the Safe Communities Act does. It also creates the prevention of a Muslim registry. Yes. So any Massachusetts resources will not be used to either generate a registry of our Muslim residents or provide that information to federal authorities, you know, separate and apart from any pre-existing requirements to do that. And so then there's also a Fundamental Freedoms Act that does the same thing, in that it prevents the creation of a Muslim registry and prevents surveillance of people based on their political speech. So if you're at a TREST Act rally, or if you are at an anti-Trump rally, or if you are at the Women's March, law enforcement should not be allowed to surveil you and create a profile or dossier on you for exercising your First Amendment rights to freedom of speech. So there is a lot of advocacy that is happening. And I think one of the most beautiful things that has happened as a result of this election and some of the things that we've seen come out is the level of awareness and activism. People's level of engagement has increased. The showing of love and support to neighbors has increased. And I think that is one of the things that is really going to help us succeed and thrive, is our ability to stand up for one another and our ability to show love. So as a Brockton resident, I'm proud to be here with you all tonight, and I look forward to continuing in these conversations.
So in Brockton, we had an active debate. I was not on the city council at the time about the TREST Act, and it was tabled, so that's fine. But during one of the hearings, we had the chief of police come in, and he was talking to the panel about the TREST Act and said many of the elements, and I'm more or less saying this for the people at home so they know, many of the elements of the TREST Act are already policy in the Brockton Police Department. If you call about a crime, if there's drug dealing on your street, if you see a woman being raped or murdered, you can call and you can report that, and no Brockton police officer is going to ask you for your immigration status. And this all circles back to the purpose of these dialogues. And the last sentence in the purpose of these dialogues is to remind our neighbors that we're all in this together. Because I live in Brockton. I mean, most of these folks here live in Brockton. And if you or one of your loved ones is being assaulted, being raped, being robbed, being in some negative, someone's house is being robbed, and someone can save you, someone can save your daughter, your son from this awful circumstance, but they are so terrified to call the police because they're afraid about their or their mother's immigration status. Who is being served by this? Certainly not myself or my family member or anyone that's being hurt. So I think that, just like they say there's a separation of church and state and all these other things, there's a fine line with a local, all of us living here in our community of Brockton, and being like little enforcers of federal immigration law. Because we're here. Michelle Dubois doesn't have control over immigration law, just like the folks here don't have control over immigration law. The immigration law is what it is. And we live in a community of 94,000 people. This is on the census. And there are many estimates that we have between 20 and 30,000 undocumented people here. We are not immigration agents. We can't deport people. But we do live in a city that has 20 to 30,000 undocumented people here. So if you live in a city of 90,000 people and there are 30,000 additional undocumented people that are your neighbors, you can understand how someone that's a fifth generation American citizen wants to make sure that the undocumented person that lives on my street, who I may or may not know, feels comfortable calling the police if they see something that's scary in the community. So this isn't about me going out of my way to be best friends with undocumented people. This is about me living in a community that has undocumented people in it and looking out for my community. And my community includes those undocumented people, sure, but 90,000 of those people are American citizens. And so they need to be protected. And if we pass, if we all get caught up in these rules, all of a sudden, what are we going to do? We're going to kick all these kids out of school? Well, a judge in a court says we have to educate undocumented children. So you have to think these things through when we say these, like when the little kid goes in to his friend and says, you need to find new parents, your parents are going to be deported. Well, that's, first off, this woman was documented, but even if she wasn't, that's an issue for her and the federal ICE agency and the immigration officials that she's working with. That isn't an issue for the little boy's parents to be telling him about their little friend in school. So I just think that we should all like check ourselves a little bit. But I wanted to do a little experiment, mostly for the camera. A lot of this session is for the camera, for people at home that might know people that are undocumented. And so I'm not outing Juliana, but there was a time that she was what some people call undocumented because she overstayed her visa, right? So what I'm thinking is, Juliana, maybe Councilor Barnes and I can move, and maybe the legal services attorneys can come here. And I'm thinking this. So Juliana's going to say, you know, I came here with my immigration status and it was undocumented. And then you're going to tell her what legal steps she could have done to cure her undocumented status. And this is going to help maybe the people at home. What do you think? It's not all, I mean, you know, we're not going to be perfect, but, you know, it is what it is. What do you guys think about that idea? I think that might be a fun little experiment. What do you think?
Sure.
Okay, Juliana, you come here. Sit here. And then you're close to the attorney.
It will be an interesting challenge because before I became a U.S. citizen, I actually probably talked to over 20 lawyers. I spent a lot of time researching, and I eventually became a U.S. citizen without the help of any lawyer because I eventually learned so much that I was able to file not only my immigration paperwork, but also the petition for eventually applying for my parents. And since then, I have pro bono have helped. I can't even count over 200 people at least start their process and eventually have them talk to a lawyer. But I did come to this country with a visa. I don't know the percentage, and I don't know really like the numbers, but I would say the majority in I do know in Massachusetts the majority of undocumented people today came here documented, so legally, so differently than some other places like California or Texas or some other states. In Massachusetts, the majority of the people came here documented, just like I did, and for one reason or another, and mostly because immigration system, it's actually a very complex system. Either their document expired, they didn't know what to do, they filed something late, or whatever happened. It's like if you go to the RMV and you get there and you're trying to do everything you can to fix, you know, your license that expired, and they're going to tell you, guess what? You can no longer do that. Good luck. And your car's right outside, so guess what? You have to drive home. So I did come with a visitor's visa, and when I came, although they kind of give you some information, they really don't explain anything, really, right? So like, I would say, how many people do you work with that actually have come and their documentation, whatever it was, expired?
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of folks, and certainly we have a lot of minor child clients who were, you know, brought here when they were very young and don't even know that they're undocumented until it gets to the time to apply for college and, you know, financial aid and that sort of thing. So it is very, very complicated, and there's so many different ways it plays out.
So I myself came here. I was underage. They gave me a visa. I came. I did not have any family in this country. I did know some people. I stayed at their home, and I went to school. I worked, and time went by, and nobody really ever explained to me, nor when I came in, or anyone really, that my documentation expired. So eventually, I wanted to get a license, and I went to the RMV, and they told me, no, you can't. I was like, okay. So I went to Social Security office to try to get a Social Security card. I actually have that paper too today, because they actually gave me a little paper that states you're not allowed to have a Social Security number at this moment. So I actually have with a stamp and a signature and everything. Then I tried to see if I could change my visa from an immigrant visa to a student visa. And at that point, they told me it was too late. Does that happen a lot?
Yes. If you've ever, you know, if you've overstayed, the hard thing and the frustrating thing for us immigration advocates is that there are very few ways to, you know, to fix your status if you came here undocumented or if you overstayed on a visa. There's very few ways in the immigration system to sort of get on the line and do it legally from the start. It's really just, it's whether you have a family member here or if you have any certain of a very few kinds of jobs that often focuses on like doctors or scientists or millionaires who are going to come and be investors. So there's very few ways for you to actually adjust that way unless, and then the other thing that we do mostly in our office is this kind of umbrella term that we call humanitarian-based cases.
So to make it clear for the people in the community, there's no such line, right? So there is some ways that people can adjust their status. And in my case, I eventually, after a long, long, long time, I married a U.S. citizen, and I applied for my adjustment of status. Luckily, I actually did have an I-94, which means I came here legally, and I was able to adjust my status. If I, for some reason, had not come here legally, if I was actually came here illegally, I wouldn't be able to adjust my status just today. So that is some of the people that you may know in the community that might be married to a U.S. citizen for the past 20 years, and guess what? They still can't have like too many. There's a lot of people that I know that haven't been able, even with the help of lawyers, depending on what happened to them in the beginning when they came, if they, you know, if they ran into some issues, they haven't been able to adjust. I was able to adjust, but unless you're married to a U.S. citizen, unless your parent is a U.S. citizen, right, or a green card holder or something like that for family base. So do you want to talk a little bit about family base?
I don't do.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
So if you are a United States citizen, you can petition for your parent, your spouse, or your child to start their process. And sibling.
If, how long is the waiting list for siblings?
For sibling, they're currently processing applications that were filed in 1993.
1993.
So it's about 20. There are some differences for different countries.
The country category makes a difference, and the F categories make a difference as well.
Yeah, so it can be different depending on where you're from.
Any particular immigration service or agency that deals with the Department of State, USCIS, all of these places, Homeland Security, all that. You have to think, the National Visa Center particularly, they get 100,000 pieces of mail a day. They get 100,000 applications like yours a day, like your potential one a day that they have to go through. That's what causes a lot of the backlog. And I mean, we've been up there. We've done congressional briefings on this. We've tried to advocate for, you know, relatives, because it gets frustrating. And God forbid you have an elderly parent that wants their, you know, adults and a daughter to come to see their grandchildren for the first time. Just had a family from China, 15 years. And, you know, parents, you know, they die and they don't get to see their family. It is a situation. And, you know, there have been conversations about how to change the formula, because the formula has been, the INA has been enacted since 1964, something like that, right? So we're still working on that system. And it's definitely, you know, back then there were fewer number of people, you know, trying to come to the United States from different countries, all these other kinds of things. So there are different factors that people are right, and there were different countries, and they put, you know, maximum visa amounts on things, and you know, all kinds of things they thought would help, but it actually backlogged the system something awful. So those conversations are happening to kind of lessen the frustration for people trying to get their family members here and do it, you know, the right way, like you say. But sometimes, you know, some people bring on their own challenge if you come in without inspection, or you've already been removed and you come back multiple times. I see that as well. And oftentimes there are no options for those folks. You know, people, they go and they get a ban, or they get poor advice from a notario and they say, well, just go back home and we'll get you back before Christmas. And then you find out that you have a 10-year bar on you. So there's all kinds of factors that flood into this whole conversation, and that's why it's good to have the attorneys here and you folks here to let people know what resources they have in the community and outside of the community, to be able to talk to somebody to find out what your options are. And again, just because a particular option doesn't work for you doesn't mean it doesn't exist. You know, you have to kind of keep looking, keep searching, figure out what would work for you, like Juliana did. She figured out, okay, this isn't working. Then she finally figured it out, and that also happens too. So just kind of putting that out there.
Great input. Juliana, will you talk a little bit about...
I wanted to see the role play, though.
I love too. You jump into the role play about how you were able to figure it out. So you did the marriage and all this, and how you were able to figure out other people's cases that might be at home watching, to give them a little guidance on where they should go. Because this is about know your rights if you're undocumented. And ICE comes, but this is really about know your rights if you're undocumented, or you have a family member that is undocumented and you want to get legal.
So first of all, for the people at home, please make sure that when you reach out for help, that you're talking to a real lawyer. This is very, very important. We are having today in our communities a lot of scams. A lot of people, they're taking money from our community members. They either... notary or tax preparers or whoever the person is. I've helped a lot of people. I never charged anybody, and I always told them, check with a lawyer. You know, like, it's important for people to do research about their own case and try to understand what's going on. But at the same time, especially for more difficult cases, they really need to talk to a lawyer. And that is like the most important. If you have friends and family at home that are immigrants, that have any questions or need help, talk to a lawyer, make sure, and I don't even know what is the best way for people to make sure that the person that they're talking to, it's an actual lawyer, whether, you know, there is like a certificate or some kind of a number or some.
So we talk about this in our presentations as well, because when there's a lot of fear, that's like ripe for people taking advantage of the situation. So only licensed attorneys and people who are authorized by the immigration system, they're called BIA accredited representative. Those are the two only groups of people who can give you legal advice about immigration. And of course, you know, a lot of our community organizations and community partners, like Juliana is saying, sort of help and advise, because you've been doing it for a long time. But it is, you know, there are very few immigration cases that are cut and dry, very simple. So it really, really is important to talk to attorneys before you file anything, because the other thing with immigration is if you file something today and it doesn't work out, but something was a little bit wrong, you know, 10 years from now, it could come back to really hurt you again.
You want to talk about so ways that you could have helped me. So let's say I came to you and I came on a visitor visa. For some reason, I didn't really understand the whole process or the dates, and my visitor's visa expired. I am here, I'm going to school, and I'm trying to adjust my visa to a student visa. What are my options? 3-4 months went by, I don't know how long time went by, and I didn't really know there was such a timeline. What are my options?
Okay, so I think what I'm gonna do is just sort of do like what our general consult and intake questions are, because that will give an idea of the kinds of scenarios that might result in there being a path for you in that way. So, all right, so how many times have you entered the United States?
Once.
And how did you enter again? Can you explain that again?
Through an airplane in New York.
Okay, and immigration checked your passport and checked your visa. Okay. And when did that stamp expire?
About maybe 6 months ago, 3 months ago. I don't remember exactly, but.
Okay. All right, so do you have any other family members in the United States?
No.
Okay. Do you know if, even if they're not here right now, do you know if ever in the past, like your grandparents or anyone was ever in the United States for any period of time?
No, my parents live in Italy. They've been there for 20 years. I'm originally from Brazil. My great-grandparents are from all over the world. I have family in Australia, in England, in Portugal, but no one in the United States.
And I just asked that question because there is this very archaic part of immigration law, which sometimes people don't even know it, but they can derive citizenship if a grandparent lived here for a certain period of time. So that was why I was asking those questions.
That's a good question.
That's great. I didn't know about that. See,
it's very strange. Okay, so have you ever had any problems here in the United States, sort of anything happened that you had to call the police?
No, I was always afraid of calling the police. Even if I saw something, which I did not call the police many times because I was scared. And that's the truth. I have never had any issues with the police myself. I've seen certain things that maybe I should have reported, and I didn't. I've been going to school. I've been volunteering in my community, in my church, and that's about it.
Okay, and have you yourself ever had any problems with the police, been questioned by them or been stopped in your vehicle or anything like that, any kind of interaction with the police?
No, only in health fears. That's about it.
Okay, and tell me about your situation in your home country. Why is it that you came here?
It is a little complicated because my parents moved to Italy, and I actually moved to Italy. My boyfriend at the time, family, lived in the United States. They are the ones that received me here. I went to Italy and then went back to Brazil. Didn't like Italy. I was 17. Went back to Brazil with my boyfriend, and then we only had enough money for one ticket, so I came. He also had a visa, but I came just a little before 9/11, and his visa actually got canceled right after 9/11, so now I'm stuck at his family's house with no money. My family is in Italy. I'm trying to figure things out here, and he's back in Brazil. Then I find out he was actually not the nicest person, so which was a great thing. I know 9/11 is a terrible thing, but I will say, actually, in a sense, saved my life, and I am not going back to my country, and I really didn't feel I could go back to Italy, because whether I'm undocumented here or there, it's going to be the same thing.
So I think, I mean, those are some of the general questions we ask because they lead to some of the different avenues for relief. Family-based relief, if you're a victim of a crime or human trafficking, that can be an avenue to relief. If you, if somebody has fear to return to their home country, that can be an avenue for relief. So, and then you said you ultimately ended up doing it through marriage, which, you know, is another.
8 years later.
Yeah, so it can be a way to adjust for folks who came in and overstayed their visa or folks who came in through the border without inspection if certain factors apply. So again, it all just depends on the case at hand, and it's all very fact specific. So it sort of just goes to show why.
A lot of sex trafficking in the city. Could you talk a little bit specifically about that avenue to get citizenship?
So there is a visa called a T visa for victims of sex trafficking or labor trafficking. Usually what ends up happening is, we have to sort of prove to immigration that it happened, that whoever was the victim of the trafficking suffered, substantial harm from that process. And then we need to show that, you know, there was some assistance in helping to investigate what happened. So again, it's all fact specific. So call and get an immigration consult.
Great. Would anyone here like to take the mic and talk a little bit about any of your experiences or give any
questions for the attorneys?
Real
quick though, if anybody else has questions, I would be mindful about revealing stuff about your personal status because we don't know who all is in this room. Yeah. We don't know who all is watching. So be mindful about your discussion about your status.
Several things that have gone on here are already on Facebook. So just to let you know.
Yeah. So the question is like she comes here on a visa, which means she was authorized to be here. And in that case, you have an immigration check and everything. What somebody wants to bother to come here? Once you are in this country, you don't need a visa to travel. That's correct. So is there any possibility for those people to become legal? And if yes, what are the process of doing that?
Can you repeat that to me?
So the question was for folks who crossed the border without permission and never had a visa or permission to enter the country, if there is a way for those folks to do an immigration process. And the answer is that yes, there are many different ways, and it's sort of a very long conversation,
case by case.
Very case by case. But some of those things that I talked about, if you're a victim of a crime, if you have a fear to return to your home country, if if you are married to a U.S. citizen or permanent resident, those are some ways. But that's like a very big conversation to go through all of those different avenues. But the basic answer is that yes, there are ways to accomplish it, and it can be more complicated because you entered without permission, but there are ways to do it.
Can I say something too on that? Just things that I've seen too recently is a lot of people that come to my office, they've been here several years by this point, and you know, either they've their paperwork has caught up to them, or they had some kind of deportation, a removal order from another state, and they fled to Massachusetts, and now it's kind of catching up.
So there's a lot there. That question was about folks who have TPS, and if from Haiti specifically. TPS is temporary protected status for people who, for whatever reason, whether it's political turmoil in their home country or natural disaster, the U.S. government has decided to grant them temporary status here. And so the question was, especially regarding folks from Haiti who have TPS, if the program is not renewed for Haiti by the government, and those folks then go out of status, would they be subject to deportation? So there is, first of all, we still don't know exactly what's going to happen with the TPS program for Haiti. We're still waiting to hear. Second of all, it's a case-by-case scenario. And there may be ways to resolve the status in another way. We would also, like to hope with whatever humanitarian program like that, you know, maybe we don't know what will happen. We don't know if immigration would then go after those folks or not, because it hasn't happened, so we can't say.
Yeah, I mean, the reason why I ask that question is the fact that, you know, a lot of people see undocumented people as criminals. Mm-hmm. So what I mean is, like, the moment you mention undocumented, you become an automatic criminal. So a lot of folks don't know that.
And that is a great example. Because we're talking about people that today are documented, but tomorrow, if our president decides they will go from documented to undocumented, which what some people out there might call illegal. And in reality, and that is what the majority of immigrants in this country have faced. You go from having a driver's license to having an expired driver's license, and then from going to the RMV and them telling you, guess what? You'll never be able to drive ever in your life. And you're like, what? I have a car. Like, I have to go to work. So, I mean, it's very complicated, but in a sense, it's very simple. Because somebody has an expired document, it doesn't make them a criminal.
You know, so you need to understand, immigration law is not a criminal law. It's a civil, it's a civil infraction. I mean, people need to understand, people are coming here, then, you know, you don't become criminal unless you commit a crime on the street or whatever it is. So it's us as a community to educate our community to let people know, you know, it has nothing to do with crime. And also one of the things that Attorney Hassan for SLU said, you know, remember, people come to this nation not because they wanted to. A lot of us were forced to come to this country, like Haiti and so forth, like Guatemala, you know, like Mexico, you know, all those gangs and all this violence and rape and so. And also, we have to talk about the U.S. imperialism, the war that America created other countries, destroyed other countries, like what's happening right now in Syria. You know, we are forcing people out of their land, like the way we did with Native Americans when we came here to the shores. My great parents were here over 100 years ago. They came, they worked hard. You know, and so we need to go back to the history and understand the facts of it. You know, I agree with the attorney about the TPS. I mean, it's something that is understudied, you know, but with this new administration, we don't expect anything to happen because what we hear, what we see, that, you know, it's people are against immigrants, period, especially our color of skin. It has nothing anymore to do with, because Europeans are not coming to this nation anymore. Now it's us, well, black and Latino. Well, but
Bishop,
but in
we
number,
we have a very large number of Irish undocumented in Massachusetts.
Correct, we do, but it's not the same as used to be before.
A lot of things I see in my office are people that have come here on tourist visas. They've come to visit, and they, you know, were here 3 months or 5 months or whatever what it was, and then they ended up overstaying, and they stay for years, and they get jobs, and then they get married, and all these things. And then when they go to, if they get married, they find someone to file for them. And I didn't know how this kind of worked. They get someone to file for them, or they get a job, employment-based. But then the petition gets rejected, or it's intent to revoke, because there's an instance of fraud. Because when they originally came, they came for tourists, which is not to try to adjust after you get here as a tourist, but they were supposed to go home and do it the right way and all these other kinds of things. Are you guys seeing any of that, that people are getting intent to revoke? Not just work, just family-based too.
Yeah.
The 130s are getting rejected right out of the gate because they came as a tourist. And I'm assuming that the rationale is that your intent was to immigrate when you came here as a tourist, which constitutes fraud. So that's what I'm thinking is happening.
I don't have an answer for it, okay. Unfortunately. Sorry.
Fairly.
Go ahead.
Do you want the mic?
There may be other ways to resolve the status if TPS is canceled. What are those, the ways you were talking about earlier, like
yes.
family members
mm-hmm.
in the country?
Yep. Exactly. Whenever somebody is out of status or goes out of status, it's always important to do a consult and talk about new situations and things that have changed in their life that might lead to a different resolution.
So it would be good for them to document things now along those lines.
I think for any immigrant in the country, no matter what, it's very important to keep as many documents of everything and anything. Yeah. And if you send anything to immigration, make sure you keep copies, because I'm not saying anything bad or good, but they do get a lot of mail. And in some cases, it could get lost. So it's very important to make sure you keep copies. But I want to address something else, too, that I get a lot of questions. Some of my American friends would say to me, oh, but why didn't you fix that before? Why didn't you get in line? Or why? You know, like, which is fairly, you know, normal questions. And the reality is, yes, it did take me close to 8 years to adjust my status. I was documented, then I was undocumented. And I, like I said, I talked to many, 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 many lawyers. And the reality is, it wasn't that long ago. The reality is, there is no such line. There was no such way for me. I could have paid $20,000, $10,000. No one, and which many people took advantage of people just like me and are taking advantage of people just like me today. There is no law. The immigration law, it's very old. So for other people out there that might say, we are a nation of laws. Yes, we are. And we have two elected officials here that can help that help make laws. However, our laws are changing and change every day. In terms of immigration laws, the actual line that people talk about was created a long, long time ago for people that didn't even reflect the current immigrants today. So in reality, our laws needs to change in order to address our current. So yes, we are a nation of laws, and our laws have to change in order to address our current issues. So that is why we have lawmakers that have jobs. Because if we were a nation of laws and our laws were the same for 100 years, what would happen? So I think sometimes people need to reflect a little bit about their statements. Because if we were going to continue with the same laws we had in the, what is it, when was the immigration? In before the 60s, what was women's rights then? What was child labor then? I don't know. So I mean, do we really want to go back to what it used to be?
Well, we were thinking you're tired and you're poor, you know, back then. You know,
so the reality is, yes, we are a nation of immigrants, and we are a nation of laws, but our laws need to adjust according to our needs.
I mean, it's like what you said, it's like having a green card, which means being illegal. It's like when my dad came to this country, I mean, they gave him a green card, there was no expiration date. There was no date. It's like, this is your card, whatever. But when I come, my card has like for 10 years, which means after 10 years, if I don't renew it, I would be an automatic undocumented. So the complexity about the situation that we are dealing now is the fact that I'm so glad the law is out there. It's like being undocumented does not automatically mean that you are a criminal.
Or a bad person. So what you're saying is there was a time that when your dad came to this country, his green card didn't have an expiration date. But some changes happened, and when you came to this country, there was a 10-year expiration date. So it's almost like your dad could have stayed here 15 years and no one would be calling him illegal and treating him like he's a criminal. And now we just have human beings here, and the law has changed. And so that's a federal law. Again, as city and state officials, we don't have control over those things. What we do have control over is loving our neighbor, trying to find solutions to community problems.
You can petition, you organize something about the DC margin.
You can vote.
Yeah, so we can vote. We can vote for people that care about issues that affect our community. And so I just want to remind everybody that the whole purpose of these discussions of difference are to let people out there in the community know that they're not alone, So last month it was focused on, I would say, the civil rights movement, people of color, the struggle of racism, and in the lovely words of John Lewis in his struggle. And this month we're talking about the immigrant story and what we're saying to the people at home in Brockton, that you might be in your house and you don't know what to do, that you're not alone, that there are a lot of people in Brockton that are undocumented, that there is help, that you're not a criminal. It's just that your citizenship documentation is got to be worked on. And you should take the impetus and call legal services and find an attorney to talk about your situation so you can figure out if there's an avenue for you to correct your immigration status. I mean, I think that's the one thing we all want people to do. If they can correct their immigration status, they should start, right? Would you say that's consensus here? And don't just sit on your hands thinking you can't do anything. And I think, I don't know if I have more to offer right now. Does anybody else want to offer? We got to leave here in 10 minutes anyways. Yes, sir.
A couple of questions. Council, you mentioned about Facebook. And yes. Today there's been this horrible vitriol directed to you, Michelle.
Not making it. Yeah.
On Facebook, I just wonder, has there been any kind of extrajudicial or vigilante kind of anti-immigrant acts, is one question. I'm afraid of that.
Yes.
And second of all, can undocumented immigrants serve in the armed forces and maybe find a path to citizenship through that?
Yes.
All right, and then lastly, as an American citizen, I assume my citizenship. But if I were stopped by an ICE agent, how do I prove, can I be hassled as much as anybody else? I assume that I can. How do you prove your citizenship, other than having a passport, which I don't normally carry with me?
Those are great questions. Who's going to take those questions?
Yeah. I didn't answer before. She let me give an example of the card that they give to the people that are undocumented.
So question number one was?
The Miranda right. Remember that?
It's more of a comment, but given the fact that we've seen this today.
I have a young brother, my youngest brother, Alfredo Miranda. He's a police officer now in California. He came here as it would be B2, visitor's visa. He went to Brock High School, and then he went to the war. You are out of the country as a U.S. military. He came back and now has a family as a police officer in California. So he came here with document, but expired like anybody else.
So he could
enlist. Yes, he
so
did.
He enlist, yeah. So that's a good
and,
avenue.
And today
for
he's a police officer
people
in California doing a great job out there. So, yes, there is tomorrow. There's hope.
Yeah, that is something that a lot of people don't know. There is a lot of people that were not U.S. citizens that have joined the military. And in some cases, they have been given green cards and citizenship. I believe
citizenship, though. If you're in the military, you can file straight through the N-400.
I know cases. Some bad stuff.
I wouldn't say automatically.
No, they don't. Yeah, they allow them to apply for a green card.
Right. I just don't want everyone to think that if you join the military, you can get immigration status.
No. No, it'll go case by case, but I know of cases personally. I know people that also have joined the military. And for Americans to know, too, there are people that are fighting out there that are not U.S. citizens. And that's the reality. But
I can take the harassment. I've gotten calls from people, and I've talked to people in the community that have, I have not personally met these people. I think that they're kind of afraid to talk to someone that looks like me generally, but they have been beat up, undocumented people in the city of Brockton have been beat up.
Yes.
I think that inspired by racism, and I believe that I don't know how, just like I said, my Vietnamese friend, no, I don't know how you could tell she was a citizen or not, but these people were beaten up and they were undocumented. So there is that kind of hate where people take it among themselves to be vigilantes, and if someone has an accent, they could be a citizen or not, take it among themselves to beat that person up. So the purpose of this meeting is to say that that's wrong and we should never be using violence.
And illegal.
So just in regards to acts of violence, there's a hotline. The Attorney General, Massachusetts Attorney General, has a hate crimes hotline, and it's 1-800-994-3228. And that's for anyone who has been a victim of a hate crime. And so they're tracking those incidents, and it's important for that information to be known, because you're right, there are people taking things into their own hand, motivated and inspired by some of the rhetoric that we saw during the campaign and that we're still hearing in the aftermath, particularly targeted a lot at Muslim women because they wear a hijab and they're highly identifiable, but also Latino. And
yeah. So we have a nice lady in the audience that would like to say something. Yes?
They want the number again. I have a question. I don't know if I can get an answer for it, but I'm going to make it anyway. I am someone that is active helping the community here in Brockton. And one of the questions that I get a lot is, what is this thing about a sanctuary city? Why they're saying that our city government is going to work with our president to collect all the immigrants? And then they are saying, well, the city officials are also talking, they're afraid that our president will cut the federal financial support. So all these things combined is creating a lot of nerves and confusion, and it seems like nobody is doing anything to calm the community. And my main concern is that when things get so confused, and certainly with the kind of president that we have right now, there are a lot of bad people that would probably say, this is my chance to do what I like to do and do what I couldn't do. My question is simple. Can our president take into consideration that we are a country of laws? Can our president actually select sanctuary cities, create all this fear, all this confusion, and scare the elected city official that he's gonna hurt them where they cannot support, which is financially? Is that legal?
Well, I'm gonna hand it off to the ACL attorney, but I will say this. I will say that Massachusetts, like California, are donor states, which means we give more tax revenue back to the federal government than we receive. I'm not saying that we're going to say we're going to stop giving that, because that's part of being part of the team. But we are donor states, and we'll see what attorney says.
Right. I think there are some questions that still need to be evaluated around the legality of those claims of withdrawing federal funds for participation or claiming sanctuary status as a city. Now, certainly there are certain obligations that local municipalities have, but the notion or the idea of being a sanctuary city, it's not a legal term. It doesn't have a legal definition. So that can mean any number of things. And so I think it's just a lot of hyperbolic rhetoric. They're just what do they call saber rattling, making a lot of noise to scare people. And in fact, it's working because people are scared. But it's the ACLU's position that municipalities should stand strong to have safe communities. Because like we talked about before, it's very important that people in community feel safe trusting in law enforcement. And if the federal government is going to withhold funds, there are already some legal challenges against the federal government for that. I take it that there will be more. And then I think it's also important for local for states to stand up. And so when there was a conversation about the repeal of the Affordable Care Act, Governor Baker said, we will continue to make sure that Massachusetts residents continue to receive health care. I think similarly, we need to make sure that our governor and our elected officials continue to provide support to our local cities and towns. So it's not a direct answer to your question, but because some of that would have to be litigated in court.
I want you to clarify. You said sanctuary could be anything. Now that is general. When we have a president that campaigned saying that the cities that were becoming the sanctuary for illegal immigrants, that is directly connecting there, so you cannot make it general.
So we can't make the, but what a sanctuary city is doesn't have a particular legal definition. And so one thing that one city does to claim we're a sanctuary city might not be as robust and comprehensive as what another city does. But again, the whole point is the president is using rhetoric and scare tactics to make everybody afraid if they're doing the most to be a sanctuary city or if they're just doing a little bit to be a sanctuary city.
But I think in the end we've realized, and especially from the people that are working in Brockton and in communities of immigrants, there's a lot of fear and there's a lot of unknown. And none of us have all the answers, right? But I mean that, but together we have to, we're all in this together. And that is really the topic of these discussions. We're gonna be having another discussion next month on what date? I don't remember. 25th of April. It's going to, it's the one in May is going to be about religion. I believe next month we're going to do one about women and how women have been excluded and how we can include each other and feel more together. So thank you very much for participating, and I want to thank you all very much for all your help. Thank you.